morning, church. It's good to gather together today. Let's stand up. And if you're out in the lobby, come make your way in. Start our morning, and we're going to sing to the Lord. I was thinking about how throughout history, we read throughout Scripture that people have a response to the Lord and what He's done in song. When He's delivered them, they sing. When they are searching for Him, we see in the Psalms that there's a song to the Lord. When there's celebration, we sing. And so that's what we're going to do together today. We're going to sing because He has delivered us. He is faithful. We also sing because we need Him. And so that's going to be our response this morning. Come on in and find a seat, but don't sit. You guys good today? Yeah, how are we doing? Good to be together? All right, let's sing.
We worship the God
guys came to sing to me. Actually, you guys always do. You guys always come ready to sing, so I can't say that just today. Psalm 150, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Hallelujah. Praise him with the trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with the tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Man, this sounds like a party. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Yes, let everything that has breath praise the Lord for who he is and what he's done. Amen? Amen. All right.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand when everything around me shakes.
Rain came with blue, my house was Such a great truth to be reminded of. The battle belongs to the Lord. Why don't you take a seat? I'd like to invite our ushers, if they would come forward. We're going to take communion today. And so they're going to be passing out the trays down the row. And if you could just take the cups, we've got two cups. We haven't done this in a while, right? Like this. So there's two cups, and just hold those until the very end. And we're going to celebrate all that Jesus has done for us. Communion. It's one of the things that the church is left with today to remember the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. And for those of us who are believers, this is a great time to celebrate and to be reminded of his goodness to us. And so if you're a believer, you know Jesus, we're going to invite you to be a part of this. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, I want you to be drawn to the tenderness of the love of the Lord. And that today you might be able to see all that he has done for you. We'd love to have an opportunity to meet with you and talk with you more about God's love for you. See, the fight, it's the Lord's. It's everything the Lord has done. We're reminded way back in the book of Exodus, there is God took care of the people of Israel. He got them out of Egypt, out of bondage, out of slavery, and as they were traveling, they got to the Red Sea. And when they got to the Red Sea, they could hear Pharaoh and his armies pursuing him. They could feel like they were left all alone on that day. They were at the brink of the Red Sea, and they could see no way. There was no hope. There was nothing they could do but God. And God, in his incredible mercy, opened a way for the children of Israel to go through that day. I'd like to read to you verse 14. It says, "The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still." The Lord will fight for you. Just be still. As we sang together, the battle belongs to the Lord, right? The battle belongs to the Lord, and we have battles every day, and this is a way bigger battle over sin and death. And Jesus has provided a way for us when we could see no hope. Jesus provided a way. That's the good news of the gospel. And that's what we're celebrating today. When death was pursuing us, when we could feel the pressure of sin on our backs, there's nothing we could do but God in his incredible mercy. Instead of his wrath that he could have easily poured down on us, he offered us the gift of life. And that's what we're commemorating today. That's what we're celebrating today. That's what we're remembering today. We did not do anything ourselves. It's all about Jesus. Colossians 2, if you'd look on the screen, is a great reminder of that. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the change of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He's taken it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Church, that's a great reminder. Darkness has no longer victory over us. Sin no longer has victory over us because of Jesus. That's why we remember together. And so we're going to sing a song just to draw our hearts in, to be reminded of this great truth, and then we're going to take communion together. So let's sing this song. Jesus and the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, and after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So much to be thankful for. Let's stand to our feet. Let's sing this truth with fervency in our hearts, church. Let's be after this. Sit down, tell that person right around you, "Jesus, what a powerful name." Well, good morning, Harvest. Glad each of you are here today. My name is John Smith. I'm one of the pastors here, and delighted to see each of you that we get a chance to worship together today. If this is your first time to Harvest, super glad you found us, and would love to have an opportunity to meet you after the service. We've got a little welcome counter in the lobby. I want to be hanging out there, and some of our staff will be there. And so we would love to meet you, get to know your name, and a little bit about how we might be able to serve you this week. And so please do that. Hey, if everyone else could take out their phone right now, you could help us out by checking in today. There's two ways that you can do that. The first way you can do it is you can scan a QR code near you. The second way is if you have the app on your phone, or maybe you could download the app, you can check in and let us know that you're here. There's also an opportunity inside that app and on the scan to let us know how we can be praying for you this week. And so if there's something that's heavy on your heart, would you just put in a prayer request? And today, as Pastor Tommy preaches, there's an opportunity for you to use that app. You'll see some sermon notes, and you can find your way through that, and you can even take notes in the app. Hey, junior high, you guys just got back from camp, the 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. I hope you had an exciting week. And we've got a service designed just for you during this hour. So if you're a 6th, 7th, or 8th grader, you can go. Wow, check out those guys waving for you. They are ready for you. So 6th, 7th, 8th grade, why don't you make your way over to the Cornerstone Cafe. That's awesome. You know, every week we finish our service with this phrase, you are loved. And we're reminded every week that we get a chance to go out on mission for the Lord. And so as a staff, we were talking about what are some other ways that we can do that? How can we be on mission and show the love of Jesus? Well, there's one thing we all have in common. These times are really difficult right now. Inflation's hit. And we might be bumping into some people who could use a little something. So maybe you could buy a couple gas cards and have them on the ready. Or maybe you could go to a food store and buy a couple gift cards and have them on the ready. And when you see someone who might just be in need, just give them a card. Just say, hey, Jesus loves you. Maybe it opens up a conversation for you to engage with them and share the gospel. Maybe it's something that comes up a little bit later. But let's take every opportunity we have to be on mission and to show the love of Jesus and to love our neighbor. Maybe someone could use some food. Bring them to the Hope Center. We're open on Saturday from 10 to noon. We just want to be able to care for people in their time of need. And I'm glad we're not the only church in the area who's trying to focus on how can Jesus be high and lifted up? How can Jesus be out in the community? There's another church in our area called North Suburban Church. They're in Deerfield. And Pastor Tim is preaching the gospel this morning. And so I would like for us to join in praying for North Suburban Church as they gather together this morning and as they are on mission this week. God, you are so good. We've just been reminded of your goodness toward us and that your grace and your mercy is something that we so don't deserve. Thank you for Pastor Tim. Thank you for his passion to communicate your gospel. Would you have your way with him today as he opens your word? May he proclaim it with boldness and clarity. Would you have your hand of favor on them as they continue to reach out into the community and proclaim your truth? We love you, and we ask for you to do a mighty work in that church today and this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you know, every week we come together as a church, and we get to share our first fruits because the Lord's been so good to us. And so we take up an offering, and there are several ways that are listed on the screen behind us. But I'd like to read this verse because this is what the heart is behind giving, knowing who God is and how he loves us. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be greatly shaken. So as you think about all the uncertainty of the day, as you think about the finances that the Lord has asked you to steward, remember that truth. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress, and I will not be greatly shaken. He's a good God. He loves us. He's caring for us. And so let's give with that on our hearts today.
Rain came with Morning, church.
Good morning. It's good to see you all this morning. Great to worship together, isn't it? Come on. Awesome. Well, we had a big moment in our nation this weekend, and I just wanted to take a moment to... All right. I want to take a moment to pray. Would you pray with me? Lord, we come to you today with gratitude and thankfulness in our hearts for the decision that took place this weekend at the Supreme Court with the overturning of Roe versus Wade. Lord, each child is formed by you in the womb and has been made in your image and so has great intrinsic value. And so, Lord, we thank you for the protection that you have granted to the preborn children that will come from this decision. And Lord, we also, in this moment, we pray for peace for our nation that has been and remains so divided on this issue. Would we treat others who think differently than us with love and grace and with charity? And not just peace in our nation, Lord, but peace in the hearts of the women who are now so fearful in our country of what is to come, thinking that abortion was their only way. Lord, would you be the comfort of their hearts even now, God? And would you cause us as your church in this moment to rise up, understanding that this is not the end, but the beginning, that there is much work to do on this issue in our very state, and there is even more work to be done with caring for the children who are born and caring for moms and dads trying to raise those children. Would you bring us to passionate action, to open our homes and our empty rooms, to open up our schedules to get involved in their lives, to open up our finances and to support those who are struggling, to open our hearts for adoption just as you have adopted us as your sons and daughters. Lord, I pray that this would not be a hollow victory, but one met with meaningful change and action by us and also your church around our nation. And we pray these things in the strongest name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Lots to celebrate this weekend, church, and but more than that, lots of action to be taken by us as a church. Amen? Amen. Well, I want to start off our time by telling you the story of mine and Kelly's second date. If you know our story at all, you know she rejected me quite a few times, a lot. We won't talk about it. But then she finally said yes, and we went on our first date, and I wanted to impress her. So, of course, I took her to the Cheesecake Factory, because that's where you take people you want to impress, right? And so we went, and I was so nervous. I was, like, sweating. Do you remember that? Yeah, I was sweating all over the place. I'm bumbling over all my... It's a big deal, you know? And I felt like I blew it, but miraculously, she agreed to a second date. And so I'm like, well, now I have to, like, step it up, you know? I got to go beyond the Cheesecake Factory. And so... I made this plan. My plan was to pick her up from her house. She lived with her parents in Schaumburg, and then I was going to take her to Maggiano's at the streets of Woodfield, right? We don't have those types of things in Wisconsin, all right? And so I'm like, that sounds amazing. And then after that, we'll go and we'll get some dessert, and it'll be such a perfect night. And so I pick her up. We go to Maggiano's, and we get up to the hostess, and I'm like, a table for two, please. And she's like, oh, well, you know, it's Friday. It's really busy. That'll be about an hour and a half wait. And I'm like, I should have made a reservation. We don't have to do that in Wisconsin. I don't know, like, I didn't know. So I'm so apologetic. I'm like, Kelly, I'm so sorry. I can't believe that I didn't make a reservation on a Friday night. I'm so stupid. Maybe we could just go down, you know, on the other side of the streets of Woodfield and go to, like, Big Bowl or Tokyo Pub. And so we go over there, same thing, right? Same thing, hour plus wait, and my plans, my perfectly crafted plans, just fell apart, gone. And I was so, like, embarrassed, and I'm like, I'm so sorry, Kelly. We get back into the car. She puts her hand on my forearm, and she says, Tommy, we can just go to Chipotle. And so we did, and it worked, okay? It was okay. Everything worked out all right, okay? And... But isn't that the worst, when a plan just absolutely falls apart? Like, if you're type A, you're like, yeah, no, that's actually my worst nightmare. That's like nails on a chalkboard. Like, a plan falling apart, that sounds awful. And we're going to see something similar in the text today. We're going to, the title of our time together is When It Feels Like the Plan Fell Apart. When It Feels Like the Plan Fell Apart. We're going to be in 1 Kings 17, 17 through 24. And we've been going through our series on Elijah. And if you've been with us for the past couple of weeks, you know that there was a plan in place. God had a plan for what was going on, and he was sharing it with Elijah. First, Elijah went to King Ahab, who was a terrible king. And he went to him and said, there's going to be a drought in the land. There's not going to be any rain that falls. And then God says, depart from there and go to the brook at Cherith. And so he does. He listens. He goes to the brook at Cherith, and he stays there, and God takes care of him just like he said he would. There was water to drink at the brook, and the ravens brought him food and sustained him. And then because of the drought, the brook dried up, and God told Elijah, go to Sidon and find this widow, and she's going to take care of you. I've commanded her to do so. And so he does. He departs, and he gets there, and he sees the widow outside of the gate, and she's collecting sticks, and he asks her for some water, and she gives him, she goes to get him water. And then he asks to also have a morsel of bread. And then she tells him, well, you know, that's actually why I'm out here gathering sticks, is because we don't have really any supplies left. We have one more meal. And I'm gathering these sticks to go home, to prepare that meal, to eat it with my son, and then die. So they were facing some severe supply issues. They were on the verge of starvation. And then the word of the Lord comes to Elijah again, and it tells him to say to the woman that the flour in the jar won't run out, that the oil in the jar won't run out. And that's exactly what happened, isn't it? Everything was going according to plan. All of the things that God said were going to happen happened just as God said that they were going to happen. And then we get to our scripture for today. Verse 17. It says, after this, the son of the woman, the widow, the mistress of the house, became ill. And his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. That phrase, no breath left in him, means that he died. In the ancient day, the symbol of being dead was that there was no more breath coming out of your mouth. And so this isn't just a bad sickness. This isn't hyperbole. This is death. The boy of the widow dies. Now, wait a minute. Hold on. God didn't say anything about this, did he? God didn't mention this during the plan. So what's happening? It seems like the plan is falling apart. How could this be part of the plan? How? That God would save this widow and her son from starvation just for him to die of an illness just days later? How could this happen? It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make sense to the widow either. And she says in verse 18 to Elijah, what have you against me, O man of God? That's sarcasm there. You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son. Here's what we see. When it feels like the plan fell apart, we try to search for the explanation. There's a search for an explanation. If we see the widow doing that right here, she's trying to explain what happened. She's finding an explanation, and she's accusing Elijah. You know, I know what happened. It was you, Elijah. It must be you. You brought this upon my family. You killed my son. How could this happen? Why has this happened? Is it because of my sin? Is this punishment? What did I do wrong? I thought that I was doing what God asked me to do, and now this. And you can even hear it in her accusation of Elijah. She's kind of asking, is God even good? Elijah, are you really good? And we all do this, don't we? We all do this when the plan seems to fall apart in our lives. We search for an explanation. We try to. God, why did you take them? Did I mess up? Is this punishment? Could I have done something different? Why is this happening? Are you really good, God? Because this doesn't feel good. Searching for the explanation. And it's not just in extreme cases like death. This happens whenever we feel like the plan is falling apart, right? I planned my life to be a certain way. How did it end up like this? Where did I go wrong? I so meticulously planned our finances to be in a better spot. How did it get to the place that it is? What happened? I thought our marriage was going to be amazing. How did it get to the place where it is right now? I thought I did a great job as a parent. How are my kids not walking with the Lord right now? What happened? Why is our family struggling with this illness of cancer? How could this have happened? We try to make sense of something that seems to make no sense. Because we think if we can just get the explanation, it'll somehow make it better, right? Somehow make it better. We do this more often than we think. We do this with, like, our, let's say, the doctor all the time, right? If we're not feeling well, I've noticed that in my aging body, things are falling apart, right? And so you go to the doctor. Hey, some things are falling apart in my body. Can you explain to me what's going on? And the doctor does, right? They give you a diagnosis. Well, you see, you have a fever. And you're like, ah, that makes sense. I have a fever. That explains everything. That's why I'm super hot, like I'm sweating, and like I understand that now. There's an explanation. And I also know the solution to a fever, because the only prescription for a fever is more cowbell. I mean, Tylenol. Tylenol, right? And that's what we think. We think that if we could just get the explanation, if we could just have it, then maybe the solution is just right around the corner. Maybe there's a way to salvage this. Maybe there's a way to fix this. And so we search for the explanation. And it's not just the widow who's doing this. Elijah does this as well. But there's like a little bit of a difference. Let's look at verse 19. And he said to her, "Give me your son." And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged. And he laid him on his own bed. And he cried to the Lord, "O Lord, my God, why have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I sojourn by killing her son?" You see that? He's searching for an explanation. God, why have you done this? Are you repaying good with evil? This woman who has obeyed your command and has shown me hospitality, are you repaying that good with an evil of killing her son? Why have you brought calamity upon the widow? He's searching. But here's the difference. He doesn't just stop with searching for an explanation. He presses on and goes further, and he petitions God. Look at verse 21. "Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried to the Lord, 'O Lord, my God, let this child's life come into him again.'" That's a prayer. That's a petition. It's a prayer right here that Elijah is praying. He doesn't just stay in the realm of human rationality and understanding. He moves his search toward divine understanding and then petitions God to intervene, right? And here's the thing about all of it. We're going to see that there's a favorable result here. But here's the thing. Even in light of that favorable result, the widow nor Elijah ever get an explanation. God never tells them why this happened. There's no explanation. And that's going to be true of us so many times in our life as we walk through trials and hardships. There's not going to be an explanation. We're not going to know why something has happened. Just like Elijah here. But look, it didn't stop him from praying. It didn't keep him from praying, and it shouldn't keep us from praying either. I think we can pull some principles out of this. Two clear things that I see in this passage is, first, act in prayer towards those around you. Do you see Elijah's first movement when the widow comes to him? The widow comes to him accusing him first. "Oh, man of God, why have you done this to me?" In that moment, Elijah could have probably gotten defensive, right? Offered her an explanation. I didn't do this to you. What do you mean, right? Could have done a lot of things in that moment. He could have also corrected her bad theology. right? Like maybe like a seminary student. Actually, God wouldn't do that, right? Like he doesn't do any of that. His first move in this moment of tragedy with this widow is prayer. He acts in prayer immediately. And it isn't just T's and P's, right? Thoughts and prayers on Facebook. He actually does it. He prays right there. That's a great example for us to follow when we see people who are struggling around us, is to not try and offer them some explanation of why something is happening, not trying to defend ourselves if there's an accusation against us, not trying to correct a bad theology in that moment, but our first move should be to pray for them, to ask God to intervene in their situation. Second thing is don't let the lack of explanation keep you from prayer. We always want the full information, don't we? I want to know all of the facts. I want to know all of the things. And that way, when I pray, I can pray correctly or I can pray all of the right things. But that's just not going to happen in our life sometimes. We won't have all of the answers. In fact, in prayer, we actually, the great thing is we don't have to have any of the answers. We don't need any of it. We can just call out to God and ask him for help. God, please intervene in my situation. Please, don't let the lack of an explanation keep you from prayer. Look at this, verse 22. And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah. Maybe you've ever asked yourself this question. Does God really hear prayers? Yes, as evidenced right here in the scripture, right? And he doesn't just hear it though, he answers. And the life of the child came into him again and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper chamber into the house and delivered him to his mother. And Elijah said, see, your son lives. Here's the second thing that we see is watch God do the unprecedented. Watch God do the unprecedented. This boy is brought back to life. This boy being raised from the dead is no small thing. I think sometimes we can kind of pass through these scriptures, right? We've got a really big scripture coming up, like Yahweh versus Baal. Like, whoa, yeah, I'm gonna get there. And so we kind of go through these passages and we're like, oh, that's really nice. Great, God is good, right? And then we move past it. Or we become really familiar with concepts in the Bible. And the more familiar with the concepts we become, sometimes what can happen is that we can become contempt of those concepts, meaning that we view them as less significant. The more familiar we are with something, the less significant it can become in our minds. And so I think sometimes, especially when we read things like people being raised from the dead, there are 10 stories in the Bible of resurrection, which isn't a lot, but we celebrate one every single year, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is actually a core doctrine of our faith, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are very familiar with the concept of resurrection, aren't we? And so sometimes we can move past these scriptures really fast. But can I just tell you, we shouldn't do that. We should sit on these scriptures, because when I did this week, it absolutely wrecked me. We shouldn't become so familiar that it leads us into contempt. It's kind of like when I lived in Wisconsin, it was our house, and then right across the street was a small airport. And at first, when we moved into the house, they would take off and land over our house, like literally over our house. It seemed like 10 feet. It was probably a little bit more, but they were like real close to our house and they were really loud. And so when we first moved there, we heard them all the time. And quite honestly, I was little, and so I was quite scared. I thought they were gonna crash into our house like all the time. Like, oh my goodness, when is a plane just gonna be coming right through our home? And I would notice it every single time. Sometimes late at night, a lot on the weekends, you would notice the planes every single time they took off, every single time that they landed. But over the years, as we became more familiar with living in that spot, we hardly even noticed the planes anymore. The sound just kind of disappeared. People would come over, they're like, what was that? And they'd look outside and there was a plane. They're like, oh my goodness. And we're like, oh yeah, they do that. We didn't even notice anymore. It had become so familiar that it became less significant in our lives, just to the point of normalcy. We can't get that way with scriptures like this. We can't. Because it is so incredible. Like I said, it wrecked me this week as I was studying it. And I want to share with you why, because this is remarkable for two really amazing reasons. The first is that this is the first occurrence of resurrection in the Bible. This is the first time that someone has been raised from the dead. I want you to think about that for a second. First time ever, okay? First time ever. It's never happened before. This is unprecedented. And Elijah, full of faith, asks God to do something that has never happened before. Think about that. He asks God in this moment to do something that has never taken place before. Never happened. Unprecedented. Seemingly impossible. But Elijah has the faith to ask. How awesome is that? Do you know what's even more remarkable than that? Is that God does it. Elijah asks for the impossible, and God answers the impossible. He does something that has never happened before. Think about that. It kind of really puts into context Ephesians 3:20, doesn't it? Now to him who is able to do more abundantly than we could ever ask or think or imagine in some translations, through the power that is at work within us. He's able to do the impossible. The second remarkable thing is that in this moment, for the first time ever, God shows that he has power over the most powerful thing in human existence, death. Humanity has been fighting death forever, battling hard, but no one has ever been able to defeat death except God. This is our God. This is our all-powerful God. And as I was reading this week, this is why it wrecked me. Why don't I pray like that? Why don't we pray like this? For impossible, unprecedented things. And I think it's because we tend to put God into a box. We put God into a God-sized box, and we give him barriers, and we say, God, these are the things that you can do, these are the things that you can't do, or these are the things that you will do, and these are the things that you won't do, and we put God in a box. God, you can't salvage this relationship. It's too far gone. There's too much hurt that's taken place. You can't. God, you can't heal this sickness. It's progressed too far. God, you can't right the wrongs of this world. It's too broken. It's too sinful. People are too evil. God, you can't bring my wayward child back. They're just too far gone. They've made too many mistakes. God, you can't raise someone from the dead. Yes, he can. And we don't pray like this because I think that we don't actually believe that God has the power to do it. Or maybe you do believe that God has the power. You're like, no, I know that God is all powerful. I know he's got the power. But maybe you think that he won't. This is fear. God, you could do it, absolutely, but you won't. God, you could do it, but what if you don't? What if he doesn't do it? Then the questions come, will my faith be able to survive that? How long can I face the rejection when he doesn't do it? And so fear keeps us from praying these prayers all together. And I'm not saying, please listen, I'm not saying that if you do these things, if you pray like this, that your situation is going to change, just like in the text here today. Trust me, okay, I've tried this with Zion. Okay, I've laid on him even, right? I did it, and I prayed. And he's like, Dad, what are you doing? And I'm like, I'm just hugging you, buddy. Don't worry about it, it's not weird. I'm not saying that it's going to change your circumstance. But what I am saying is that when tragedy presents itself in our life, there is an opportunity for the Lord to show up in power. And it may not change the circumstance you're in. It may, but it may not change the circumstance you're in. But I can tell you for sure, it will change you if you pray like this. It will change you. Here's the last thing. See faith continue to grow. See faith continue to grow. Look at verse 24. And the woman said to Elijah, "Now I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth." We see someone's faith growing here, don't we? It's the widow's faith. Faith in the voice of the Lord. Faith in the word of God. She was sarcastic with Elijah in the beginning. "Oh, man of God." Now she's genuine. "I now see that you truly are a man of God and that the voice, the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth." She now has faith in the truth of God's voice and God's word. And really, if you look at Elijah's journey, if you kind of 30,000 foot view, jump up and look at Elijah, his goal is to do exactly this. It is to bring faith in God's word. He tries it with King Ahab. He does it here with the widow. He tries it to all of Israel. He wants to bring faith in God's word, to show others to trust the words of God, to trust the voice of God. And that was accomplished here in this moment. And the widow's faith grew. But I don't think it was just the widow's faith. I think that Elijah's faith grows here as well. I think that his faith is growing. I think that in these scriptures that we're walking through, God is preparing him, growing his faith, to prepare him for the battle that is to come between Yahweh and Baal and the prophets. We see that God confirms him right in this moment. He cries out for something impossible, and God shows up in power and does it. God is saying to Elijah in this moment, "I'm with you. I hear you. Also, I can do anything." But he's also confirmed by the widow. "Now I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is true." She's encouraging Elijah. This is real. The word of the Lord in your mouth is true. You are a man of God. Encouragement. This is building Elijah's faith. I look at this section of scripture like Elijah's training arc, right? It's a preparing for the battle that is to come, right? Like think about Rocky when he's about to go fight Ivan Drago, you know, if he dies, he dies, that guy, right? And he's out in the wilderness, he's in the mountains, in the snow, and he's like running through the snow, and he's like chopping wood a lot, and then he's in that log cabin, and he's like bench pressing and punching something, probably a piece of meat, I can't remember, whatever it is, right? It's like, "Adrian," no, like he's training. He's preparing for the big battle. And God in this moment is preparing Elijah for something that is to come. A huge battle between Yahweh and Baal and his prophets and kings and queens. Huge battle. He's preparing him. And maybe you, in the moment that you're in, the circumstance that you're in right now, maybe you're in a training arc too. Maybe God is preparing you for something. Maybe you're going through something right now and it's hard. It's difficult. But he's preparing you for something. He's preparing Elijah for a battle. Maybe you're walking through a valley right now. Maybe you've walked through a valley recently, but he is preparing you, maybe, to walk alongside someone else who's going to walk through that same valley. Maybe he is preparing you for ministry. Maybe he is preparing you for the work in the kingdom of God. Maybe he is preparing you to have a conversation with a coworker or a friend or a family member. We're all being prepared for something. It's not one of those things. Here's one thing that we can all be sure that we're being prepared for, and that is eternity. We are all being prepared for eternity with God. All of us, every single one of us. We are tested by fire so that we may be shown to be pure gold. We are being prepared for eternity. God is preparing us. We are being trained so that we will be prepared when the time comes for whatever he has for us. I'm running the Chicago Marathon in October. Mm-hmm. I haven't started training yet. Starting Monday, okay? Starting Monday. I'm for sure starting tomorrow. That's tomorrow, right? Monday is tomorrow. I'm starting tomorrow, okay? I'm starting tomorrow. Tomorrow, please. Accountability, everyone. Tomorrow. I have to start tomorrow. Please. Because here's the reality is if I were to try and run 26.2 miles right now, I would die. I'm so out of shape. I also have asthma, okay? And so my legs would fall apart. My knees would explode. My hips, I don't know what would happen. My lungs would, it would just be a disaster. My mindset, I would crumble immediately. I'd be like, ow, that hurts. I'm done, right? Immediately. But on Monday... On Monday, I'm going to start training. And thank you. Yes. That's the encouragement I needed right there. Woo! I'm going to start. On Monday, I'm going to start. And here's the thing is it's going to stink, okay? It's going to be hard. It's going to be really hard. I'm going to hate every second of it, probably. I actually don't really like running. Why are you running a marathon? I don't know. Thought it would be a good idea. I hate it, and it's going to hurt, and I'm going to not want to do it, and I'm going to be sore for way too many days, and I'm going to want to quit, and it's going to be difficult. But here's what's going to happen is I'm going to, through those moments, I'm going to be training and being prepared. By God's grace, hopefully by October, if I start Monday, I will be done. I will be prepared to run in October, 26.2 miles. And my legs will be ready. They will be prepared. My lungs will be prepared. My mind will be prepared to run that distance. And I wonder what would happen if we looked at the situations and the circumstances in our life, those hardships and those trials, if we looked at them not with dismay or despair, but instead we looked at them like they were training. What if we shifted our perspective and viewed those hard, difficult moments not as despair, but as preparation, as God preparing us for something? What might that do in our lives? How might that change the way that we see the situations that we walk through? That in this moment of trial and difficulty, I'm being prepared for something that is ahead. And here's the thing is that we're not going to know what we're being prepared for, okay? We have the full story of Elijah, but Elijah in these moments, he had no idea what was coming. He didn't know that there was going to be this huge battle. He didn't know that the 450 prophets of Baal were going to, he didn't know that. But God was preparing him, even in these moments. And I believe that God is preparing every one of us as we walk through difficulties for something. So let's view it like that. Let's view it like training. Let's view it like preparation. I want to leave us with three truths when we feel like the plan has fallen apart. The first truth is that God's plans never fall apart. Okay? God's plans never fall apart. If you remember, Pastor Jeff, you've been talking about this. There's no plan B. There's no plan C, D, E, F, right? There is plan A. God's plans never fail. His plan never falls apart. He says he actually works all things for the good of those who love him and act according to his will. His plans never fail. And in fact, when we go through these and when we feel like the plan has fallen apart, here's the second thing, is that God is displaying his works through you. He's displaying his works through you. John 9:3, actually, Jesus says this. There's a man who was born blind. And they were like, who sinned, Rabbi, this man or his parents? And he says, it was not this man, that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. When we go through difficulty and trial, when we feel like everything is falling apart, it is so that the works of God may be displayed in us. And the third thing is that it is an opportunity to grow. It's an opportunity to grow. When it feels like the plan is falling apart, we have the opportunity to grow in our faith. We have the opportunity to grow in our prayer. We have the opportunity to grow in trust of God, who is all-powerful, who is with us, who hears us, who is able to do abundantly more than we can even ask or think or imagine. It's an opportunity to grow, to be prepared, to train for what God has for us next. Amen? Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for your truth. Thank you for your promises, Lord. I pray that you would help us in those moments when we do feel like the plan is just falling apart, when we feel that. We know that it's not, Lord. Help us to trust in that. Help us as we search for explanations, Lord. Would you lead us back to you? To seek you in those moments? To call out to you? And Lord, would you fill us with boldness? Would you fill us with faith? Just as you filled your prophet Elijah with faith, to pray impossible things, unprecedented things, things that have never happened before. Would we be a people who prays like that? God, we need your help in that. We need the boldness. We need the courage. We need the empowering of the Holy Spirit. Help us to be a people of faith who do that. And help us to grow, Lord. Help us to grab every single thing that we can out of the time of preparation. All of the truth, so that we will be ready for the moment that you have prepared for us. We love you, Lord. We trust you in all things. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we respond and worship.
The more that shield the cross, your buried body began to breathe out of the side, the roaring light declared the wind has no place. Yes.
to be thankful for. We have an amazing God who loves us and cares for us. But maybe you walked in here today and your circumstances or situations, it seems bleak and you lack the faith and the hope. We'd love to have an opportunity to pray with you. We're going to call on that same God who never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he wants to be present in your time. And so I'm going to be hanging out down here as well as a couple of our leaders just to call out fervently to the Lord. So don't rush off. Enjoy the time that we have in the house of the Lord. And let's go to this great God and call out to him. And then as you go out on mission this week, remember this, you are loved.